Welcome to In the Loop with Laura. Today I'm honored to have my friend Cana Lingenfelter on, and she's going to talk about something that she's been doing for several years, that is smocking. Smocking might not be something that you are aware of how to do, or maybe you're not even sure what it is, but here are some examples of things that Cana has done in the past for her family, for her daughters. Did you bring the boy one?
I brought a boy one.
And for her son, when he was very little.
So wonderful. I was thinking today how old this one is, and I think it's 17 years old. So this is an old garment. This is called a button-on right here. And a couple things I wanted to say about smocking. There's a couple different ways to do it. This right here is called an inset, where the one Laura is holding is where I smock the skirt. So there's a couple different ways that you can do that. This is called a pattern, where this has geometric and
pattern.
Picture, excuse me. This is picture smocking, and then that would be, this is a geometric and a picture. So two different kinds.
So smocking, just the fact that this is 17 years old, yeah. It looks like it's in perfect shape. This is really very much an heirloom project.
Yes.
It's something that goes way back in history. It's something that you can do today, and it's not as difficult as it looks. Cana explained this to me years ago, and she's brought a machine that helps her to make this pleating exact. Mm-hmm. And if you can do Cana cross stitch,
yes,
you can do smocking.
Yes, it's very much like cross stitching.
And it would be an interesting or a beautiful thing to produce for a child or for a grandchild. And so,
yeah.
I would love to hear a little bit more about it. Tell us, how in the world did you start this, and did you think, tonight I'm going to go home and I'm going to smock? Like, what happened?
Well, I was thinking about that, because I knew you were going to ask me that question. And my grandmother did not smock, but she would sew me garments when I was a little girl. And I can remember, and she would give them to me at Christmas time. And so she would, you know, prior to Christmas, she would blindfold me. I had to stand up on a stool, and she would measure me. And I would be so excited, and that just is such a treasure. So I have a few things that my grandmother has that have lived to tell the tale that I still have. And so I just treasured that. My mom never sewed, never really did any kind of handicrafts. That wasn't her thing. But when I grew up and I left home and I was in the Air Force and I got stationed in Louisiana, sewing and smocking and making garments was and still is very popular in the South. And so I had a very dear friend that I went to church with, and she had a two-year-old at the time when I was pregnant with our firstborn, and all her little dresses were like this. And then you would find they would buy matching bows. And there's actually a shop in the South, several of them called the Bow Shop, and you'd take your little dresses in and they would match the bow. And so it's a big thing. In the South, they tend to be very dressy. So this friend of mine taught me to sew. And then smocking didn't come until a few years later.
Until you felt comfortable actually making the garment.
Yeah, yeah. And she taught me just on a Singer machine. And then, you know, there's all kinds of different machines you get into, you know, nicer and nicer machines. And so so we kind of upgraded, and I really enjoyed it. I see it's kind of dirty. But this is just called a bit, this is a basic yoke dress.
Okay.
I didn't bring a bishop. I meant to bring a bishop. A bishop would be a rounded collar, where this
like
is square. This is a square yoke, and a bishop is rounded. And so the smocking actually goes up on the shoulders and more in a circle around the neck, and you finish it behind. I should have brought one of those. I didn't do that. But
The ones that you brought, this looks like, in terms of the patterning, it might be the easiest. Perhaps the easiest to actually do
are the geometrics.
But also if you just do a panel.
Yes.
And then insert it, is that easier than doing this where it's a geometric pattern, but then
the skirt, the only thing is running it through your pleater. You have all this material. You just have to really make sure it stays out of the way, that nothing, you know, folds in on itself. And so when you're pleating, but when you go to smocking, it doesn't matter. And these are much easier to do because you don't necessarily have to count. If anybody has cross stitch, you know how you have to count every little stitch. When you're doing when you're doing a picture, you really have to count because, you know, there's a certain amount of pleats between that puppy and that puppy. And so, and then you have to back smock. So before you do all the work before you go to sew it together.
Mm-hmm.
And then this is piping. You can pipe it. You don't have to pipe it. It just finishes it nicely.
Okay, well, let's take a closer look at, which one would you like to look at first?
I really like this one. This one's probably one of my favorites.
Let's take a closer look at this, and we can see a little bit more of what Cana's talking about when she's talking about those different elements.
Okay.
So this is the bodice for, as you said, this is a geometric for the vine.
Yep.
And this is pictorial, or was this something else?
This would be a picture. Okay. Yeah, considered a picture.
And you use French knots, too, in the center of each of these roses.
I did. Now, this is old, my firstborn. She's 20, going to be 22.
Oh, my
goodness. I think this dress, and she probably wore it when she was 3. So, you know, this dress is getting kind of old, too, but all of my girls have worn it. So it's definitely an heirloom quality, I would think. Mm. And also, when you're picking out fabric, and if this is something you want to get into, want to do, you... you know, the higher quality fabric you have, the easier it's going to be to pleat specifically, and then it will last longer to hold up better. And then you can see, do you see how it looks like it's gathered behind there? That's the back smocking. Like if I turn this inside out, you have to smock the back so it holds its shape, because if you didn't, this would all buckle out and you wouldn't have these pleats.
Okay, so do you do that before you do the design?
Yes, I always do the back smocking first.
And we're going to take a look at back smocking.
Okay. There it is.
So it means running through and just nipping through those pleats.
Yes. Well, no, the back smocking is the cable stitch. Okay. This is called a cable stitch where you see this white line right here.
And that's with the color, the same color as the...
That.
As the pattern.
Yeah, that's just... Oh, right. This is where I skipped.
Coming through.
Yeah, I skipped a couple pleats.
You can tell I'm not a smocker. Mm-hmm. So this here... And you go through and you...
It's up and down, up and down, up and down. And you can go pretty fast. And I have a little example here. I'll show you how you do a cable stitch. This is the most basic stitch. And you use the cable stitch for just about everything. Even the pictures, if you turn this back, you can see that the picture here, this bow, is made up of cable stitches. And there's different stitches. There's waves. There's baby waves. The cable is the most basic. Like these flowers, there is a French knot in the middle, but it's made up of three cable waves on the top, or three cable stitches on the top and on the bottom.
Okay.
So that's how. And all this, the green here, is called waving. You wave up, and then you wave down. You wave up. I counted, and this came actually with a pattern, and I was going to show you. I brought a book here. I can put it. I'll just put it right here.
So this is the bishop, what you were talking about.
Yes, this would be a bishop. Some of these are in upside down. And these are all patterns that I purchased in Louisiana. I'm sure you can get them now online. But yeah, there's boutique shops galore in the South.
And more of the
this
bishops.
Is a bishop.
I do remember these in that one Christmas shot that you have.
Yeah.
The girls are wearing some bishops.
This is such a sweet one. I was going to bring this dress because I actually have this dress. I did it just like this. And for Kaylin's 4th birthday, so all of my girls have worn this dress on their 4th birthday. Because the bunny, this bunny has 3 little candles, but I put 4 on my little bunny. So,
and so, Chloe wore it too?
You know, I'm sitting here thinking, I guess Chloe probably didn't.
And she's too old.
And she is 6. So I think actually I probably missed Chloe wearing this dress. Funny,
because
in
Caden.
The South, I would not put it on Caden. He is 4. But in the South, you know, you just grow up and then you move and the culture kind of changes. And people don't really wear dresses like this. And so, you know, wherever we go, my little girls don't really want to wear dresses like this. So, but Chloe will. She's still at that age where she would. Agreeable.
Beautiful. I think anyone needs
Here's some waves. This is really pretty.
Mm-hmm.
This is the one.
Mm-hmm.
Here, right here. This is the one that's in that dress. So this is where I got the idea, and it gives you all the directions on, you know, how to skip, how to count, what kind of stitch you're doing, and then on the back, it blows it up for you.
And so which way is up? This way? No. This way is up.
Yeah.
And so you put the...
The back smocking.
And you put the neon colors in so that you can see one thread to another?
I did so I could count because my eyes would, you know, kind of cross, and that helped me. Yeah, I guess I did do that a long time ago. Yep.
And then a mallards. Is that the one that you... No.
I actually might have that. I think the mallard is one I didn't finish for Cassidy. And here's this one right here. I can put
it's here.
There's that one. I did it. Yep.
You can tell what daddy does.
You can tell what daddy does. That's right. He golfs. And so my little son wore that. Isn't that funny? A little button on anyway.
That's wonderful.
I know.
So tell me about smocking then. Oh, or do you want to show these other patterns?
No.
Okay. Where does it come from?
Well, I did some research to try to answer this rightly, and it seemed like every source I found had a slightly different take on where smocking came from.
Okay.
Whether it was originally from Italy or maybe Germany or England, by and large, I think most everybody, the majority, said England and prior early Middle Ages.
Wow.
And the word smock really refers to a laborer's garment. And so smocking, when it was first done, it was in the place of elastic, because back then they didn't have elastic. So they would use it to gather sleeves if they didn't have buttons, or they would use it
to
make it more form
too, I'm sure.
fitting.
Mm-hmm. Like you would have a big, almost a nightgowny type garment, and it would bring it in.
It would, and it would give them flexibility if they worked in it without ripping their shirt. And then, of course, as time went on, you know, embroidery became... It turned into embroidery. I mean, embroidery was for rich people. Smocking is actually for more of the common people, which I found that was really an interesting little fact.
Mm-hmm. That's exactly opposite of what I would think now when you see, you know, darling girls who would never, ever spill wearing something like this. But I also think, so if that's how it started in the Middle Ages, then you think about some of the lace collars and some of the starched items that have that same...
Yeah.
Whether the smocking refers to all of these pleats put together or whether it's the decoration, but both of them.
I think it, just as time went on, probably smocking, like I did see some early more paintings and stuff in some of the different websites I went to, and it didn't really show any needlework. I think it was mostly back smocking.
Back smocking, okay.
And then, of course, as time went on, then more needlework became what they did just to beautify a garment.
So is there anything that we might recognize if you mentioned a famous example?
Yes. Leonardo da Vinci painted the Mona Lisa, and she has a smocked garment on.
Is she?
Yeah.
Is it a bow? Is it geometric?
Well, you know, it never popped out at me. It's a dark garment.
I'm thinking.
Yeah, okay. And so you have to have a real, you know, maybe magnifying glass to probably see it.
Well, and if Mona Lisa's wearing it, then it's cool.
Yeah.
And I think everyone should
wear a smocked garment.
Is smocking only for clothing? Do you have any idea? Is it ever used for anything else? Because nothing's coming to my mind.
But. No, just sleeves and collars and then the bodice part. Mm-hmm. Just to bring it together and without having to, you know, need buttons. And then, again, the flexibility part of it, I think, was the main reason for smocking.
Well, that's a little bit of the mystery open for us.
Oh,
but
okay.
Cana has brought, I mean, when I first saw these, I think Cana is sitting at home and she's got an iron and she's got, like, glasses on, and she every fold she's like she's pressing it and putting it. I just think I look at this and I think it's impossible.
Right.
So tell us the secret, please.
Okay. Well, you can do it the old-fashioned way. The original way would be to get some cornstarch and water, and you know, spray, and then iron it. So you know, you have a real sturdy garment, and then you're doing each and every little fold and ironing that. And that would have never appealed to me. I would have never done that.
There are very few people to whom that would appeal.
I would think so. I mean, you would just, that would, years, that would, I don't have that kind of time. Who has that kind of time? But it, obviously, this does take time. But this is a little machine. You know, I should have looked when it was developed. This is just called a pleater. This is an Amanda Jane. There's different kinds. Martha Pullen has one. I think there's a Sarah Jane or a Sarah something puller pleater. So this is a 24-row pleater. I have some needles missing because they do get bent, and each needle costs like $2 or $3 a piece.
Okay,
and so I would have to send off to get needles.
We have the top view now. I'm just going to point out. So there are four gears that are put together. So there might be a guy out there who might be interested in this because it's gears and it's
gears,
a machine.
There you go.
That's all I'm saying. Mm-hmm. So here you've got little ridge and they are evenly spaced on top to here. And then they're a little bit wider here.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's difficult to see with the black background. I'm just going to do this. If you can see, These are all needles that she has in and that she has pre-threaded.
Yeah, I did thread some.
But I'm assuming you buy the machine and the needles may come with it, may not.
I had to insert my needle. So this would screw, this unscrews, and you can take this one out.
Uh-huh.
And then you have to gently place the needle in whichever slot. Like here, you can place the needles closer together. This has two. This is designed to be further apart.
Right.
And you can actually put your needles closer together to have a tighter pleated garment if you wanted to. Obviously, I've used this side more than I've used this side, so these needles are missing. So that's that you can get an 18, I think there's like an 18 needle pleater. There might be a 9 one, and of course, this is a 24 one. The more needles you have, the more expensive the pleater is going to be, but they're not that expensive. I think I priced it. I think it's like $129 for a 24 row pleater. So they're not too pricey, and if you're going to get into something like this, you can. I used to take my garments to the it's called the Fabric Boutique in Bossier City when we lived in Louisiana, and it cost me $20 just to have them pleated up, and I was sewing a lot.
Six of those would pay for this.
Yeah, and I was sewing a lot, so we went ahead and bought one since I just really love. And you can pleat the sleeves as well. I've got a couple garments where I pleated the sleeves, and so anyways, it was just a bunch of fun, and I really enjoyed doing it. So yeah, so it was worth the money to me to go ahead and buy one.
You've had it for 20 years, and
I have.
I'm sure that when you start to have little grandkids, you'll probably
the
smaller garments are quicker and easier.
They are. Yeah. They are.
So you have, and these are probably a sturdier needle.
Very sturdy,
and
they're actually bent. You know, I might have one. So you can see the needle. I think I've got a couple extra I need to. Yeah, here you go, if you want to pull one out.
Sure. Oh, okay. Yeah, I would not have realized. So this is so that it does not just slip out.
Yes, it is bent to fit. You see that? So this is the part that goes back into.
And that's the tip. And then here is the eye end. So it's sitting in the machine like that over a gear. You've got your spares. So now that we have the machine out, have all the men have perked up.
All right, you ready to see it?
Yeah, I want to see what it does.
Okay.
Do you want me to, is it possible to do this with the white behind, or should I?
Yeah, you can take that out, because I'll put
the fabric in.
Okay, so what you have to do, I was going to show you, I brought a couple pieces. I've already gotten this garment prepared, although it's already getting, you want it to be sturdy. You can even spray it with some cornstarch and then iron it really good so it's stiff. The stiffer it is, the better this will roll and it won't get jammed. You have to back up. It is a little tricky. Kind of have to hold your tongue right.
I'm starting to understand how it's going to work.
Mm-hmm.
It's exciting.
It is exciting. So I'm not sure. I might have to go over here and sit down and roll it up. But I did want to show you, for you who sew or don't sew, I don't know if you see the edges of this, you know, when you go to have somebody, they cut your garment, the best thing to do is rip from side to side, because you're going to rip the grain and it's going to be absolutely straight. So you can tell I haven't cut it, I've ripped it. And then I
ironed
it.
That's just going to go into the seam of the garment. So no one's ever going to see that it was a ripped garment.
And this would be an inset. This wouldn't be a skirt. I'm not going to. This would be an inset that I would smock, not a skirt, obviously, because it's so short. Another thing that you want to do is you always want to pleat, like if you're going to pleat 7 rows, you want to thread 9 needles. You always want to have one up at the top and one at the bottom. So when you square up your garment and you hold everything tight, I'll show you when we get to the other side. I'm not
going to explain it. So you have extra to cut off or extra that goes into the seam?
You do. So for instance, let's put that back in the middle. That right here.
You can take a look at this.
Yeah. Now this one, because the skirt, you don't really have to do an extra one across the bottom. I probably did, and then I pulled it out, because you will pull these out when you're done with all your smocking.
They're a basting stitch?
Mm-hmm. Yes, it's a basting stitch. It's a holding stitch. And so then this extra one up here, I pulled it out after I sewed the piping on,
and then that
kept it straight.
Otherwise it would be so difficult, and
it would just fold
and do everything. So
yeah. You want to keep everything nice and tight. And obviously, it still buckles. You can see right there where it's not held very tight. But that's just part of it.
No, that's fine.
That's fine. Okay. So I've rolled my inset onto my my stick here. Sticks are really important. I would get a dowel rod that's, really smooth. And then you want to kind of, if you have any strings like that could get tangled up, you want to definitely pull those pull those off and throw those away. So I'm going to slide this through here like that.
Look at that.
And I could go upside down, but you know what? I think it's better to go over the top, kind of like toilet paper.
I was going to ask, is that toilet paper?
Kind of like toilet paper. Think of it that way.
I am.
Okay, so I'm going to pull this down because this is going to be what I would, let's just say this is the top of my garment right here. And then right here be the bottom.
Because, again, with her pleater, this one is...
This is not
close
threaded.
Together.
Yeah.
And this is not as close together, and this is the side that's threaded. So she is. You're not centering your garment, though.
I'm not.
You're just making sure that this edge is hitting the first needle, threaded needle.
Yeah. And I do have some extra here. I didn't really take the time to measure. Like, I don't have some pre-planned idea for this. This is just like, I'm just. For, you know, general knowledge purpose. But if I was really going to do a garment, I would have had this measure. Like, I know I want it to be 9 rows. And so I would pleat up 11 rows. And then I would cut it. So I don't have this extra just because you don't need it. I mean, you don't have to cut it, but I probably would.
So then do you do one extra needle, and then do you do an extra 3/4 inch as you would if you were to make a garment, or how far do you go past that? Is it just one needle and that's all?
Yeah,
that really matters?
I go...
Because your needle here is...
Yeah, this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8,
how
9,
wide
10,
is this?
11. This is 11. I don't really know. It's not obviously not 11 inches. I'm going to say probably 6 inches, maybe.
Okay, keep going.
And so I would maybe give it a half inch above or, you know, to the left of this first needle that's threaded, and I would, there you go.
Okay, so it looks like it's 3/8, 7.
Okay, so that's not even 5 inches.
5/16 of an inch.
Okay, each one you're taking the space. So see, this needle right here is bent. You can see how that needle's bent. And so I would probably need to take that needle out anyways because that needle would cause the garment to get jammed up in here when I go to bring it through. So you want to eye it. It is a little tricky getting it started. Once you get it started, it's okay. See how it'll catch? Do you see that?
Yep. It's like a tread of a big tractor wheel.
It is. And I'm going to eye just right here. It's good to stand over the top of it. So I hope, am I going to be in the way if I do that?
That's okay. You're eyeing it.
Okay, so look, I am 2 needles to the left of this first needle. That's fine. You don't have to be 1 needle. Actually, probably the more room you give yourself, the better off you're going to be in case. But you do want to go along the grain as much as you can. You don't want it to go cockeyed.
I can understand that.
And you just always start out slow.
Oh my goodness, look at that. It's just feeding it straight onto the needles.
And you'll go several times. It'll start getting a little tight. And then you have to come around here and start pulling them down.
Wow. I bet whoever designed this was brilliant.
Absolutely genius. I totally agree. You want to make sure that your threads, so I don't have all my threads coming out. And a lot of times, I'll just tie the end here because it will never go this far.
I don't know. Chris, can you?
Oh, sorry. I'm going to tie this end right here. I didn't do that earlier. I was going to tell you guys to do that. You want to tie that end just so these needles don't, I mean, excuse me, these threads don't slip out when you have it all done. And then these loose ends here then will be on the other side.
And you can.
And I will tie those as well.
Okay.
And then I'll center all the pleats and make it look nice. And then I'll square it off and I'll show you that here in just a second.
That's fascinating. And then you just probably have to keep making sure that your fabric's not going to the right or the left.
Yeah. So you never want to really go fast. Sometimes you have to hold it kind of tight. See how it kind of wants to buckle right there?
Yes.
You want to hold that kind of tight. And it's time to pull this off.
So she was referring to this area right here as it's feeding in, is bunching a little bit. And so when it comes out, it's really tightly folded. But she's pulling it out, and that's not a worry because all she has to do is...
It's do this, watch.
Pull it, and it goes right back exactly
see
as
that?
The pleating used to be.
So right now, I don't have to worry about that.
The machine is doing
all
the work.
Up. I'll squish it all back up here in a little bit once I get it all the way through.
So when we're talking, let's say, a 4-year-old garment, how much fabric width do you require for their little bitty bodice front? I mean, gosh, their bodice front must be not even a foot
right
straight across, but we're talking about all these pleats. How much fabric does it eat up?
Well, I just, when you buy your fabric, here, I'll just open this up. It doesn't matter the size of your child. I always get fabric that is just the average width, which, what is the average width?
45 inches.
Okay.
44 to 45 inches.
Yes. Then I always use that. And you can make that as tight with the pleats or as loose, depending on if you have a six-month-old or if you have a 12-year-old. You use the exact same width.
And is there a particular kind of fabric that you use? Is it cotton? Is it cotton poly blend? Is it wool? Does it matter?
Not wool.
Because I think batiste, which is a very, very thin
cotton. I like that, and I have made a cotton that is so nice to work with. It's just like butter going through there. The only thing about that, it's not as sturdy, and you have to iron it. And I'm just not a real champion of ironing. And the second your child sits down, you know, it's almost like linen where it just wants to wrinkle so much. It is beautiful, beautiful material.
And it's lightweight. And very lightweight.
Yes. Yeah. So this is a little sturdier. This is just like a probably cotton poly blend I got just from Walmart. But it was one of their better blends, better quality. And so that's why I went ahead and got this one.
Well, I would just be thinking, I would want it to wash well because this.
And you want it to wash well,
Some child is going to be wearing this for, you know, centuries.
Yes.
And someone's going to paint them. And it's going to be in the Louvre, so it's got to be.
Oh, I don't know about that. That's so funny.
That's amazing. It's just feeding it straight onto those needles through the
curve. Do you want to try it?
Yes, I do.
Let's trade places.
This is fantastic. No one has ever asked me to smock before.
Ooh.
I'm going to ruin it, Cana.
No, you're not.
Ooh. Just like this, then? I got to stand up. I'm learning from her. I have to stand up. I want to make sure that it's feeding in.
Probably go ahead and pull these off.
I want to pull them off.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, my goodness.
See, you're already a champion.
I can make this for my 15-year-old.
Yeah.
Just a little bibbed thing.
There you go. You know, you could probably smock a pillowcase.
That would be really pretty.
You could smock a pillow.
You could, you know, for a pillowcase, you could just do the pleating.
Absolutely.
You wouldn't even have to commit to.
Right.
During the embroidery. Okay, so with smocking, this is not hard to do the pleating. It takes a little bit of time. You want to be able to concentrate. Is the embroidery hard? Is that the trick? Is that what makes people not do it in the North?
Maybe. I don't know. I mean, who all likes to do like cross-stitching? You know, it takes time. I think it's rather therapeutic, like, you know, how you feel about knitting. You know, you can just kind of get in a groove and you can just go. But if you're doing a picture, you can't really get in a groove and keep going.
Geometric, you could.
Yes, the geometrics are great because you don't even have to use somebody else's idea. You could just make up your own thing.
Go up and down and then add a rosette where you want to.
Absolutely.
So are you telling me that you could actually travel? One of the things I like about knitting is I can throw it in my bag and go to a ball game. So seriously, you would go to a ball game and pull this out and do some smocking?
Oh, yeah. I have taken it everywhere. I've taken it on a plane. I've taken it to choir practice at church. And, I don't sing in the choir up here, but I've taken it just everywhere. And you have your little bag, just like you have your knitter's bag.
How do you make that nut bunch up?
You don't really. It's okay.
Because I don't want to ruin your smocking, Cana.
If you wouldn't ruin it.
Okay. I think I have. I think I've moved it up into the wrong needles.
Did we go up? Then we can just go back down. It's okay.
Smocking.
Actually, I have taken a garment and I've had to throw it away before because I've done the same thing. So,
I've ruined her garment.
No.
Look at that. It didn't used to be there and now it's going up. Okay, we're going to trade back.
Okay.
Go behind. I go in front. Now what?
Okay. So I'll just finish doing this real quick. I'm just going to pull it back this way. I have done that and, you know, ultimately, it doesn't really show. I don't think it does. If you had, I guess if you had colored, you know, your material, maybe you had striped.
Oh, you could do it on a checking, couldn't you?
Yeah, or checker. I have done all kinds. I guess not that one.
Yeah, but I've seen.
I have done all kinds of different colored materials. Gingham. oh my goodness, striped and calicos, and there's just all kinds that you can do it on. And those you definitely don't want to get off, because then those are going to be obvious that you didn't keep a straight pleat in it.
Well, it was my first time.
That's right. I think you did great. So see, I'm going to finish up. Watch, this will go. I'll pull this through here.
That's amazing.
Okay. So now all I have to do is finish pulling it off the pleater.
And when you do that, then you pull the threads through and the other tail end comes out.
Okay, so here's where you're just going to pull it.
This so you can.
Okay, so I've got to get these other ends on that side of the garment.
So they have to pull all the way through.
Yep.
And come out.
So you're going to keep pulling it this way. And this is where needles can get bent, where I get sloppy, and I'm doing that. I'm bending my needles. And then that's what you don't want to do.
So you just want to basically pull it straight and not pull it to one side.
And then, yeah, have a friend come hold it so I can get these pulled off. You'll see here in just a minute they'll pop out. And then I'll show you the next step. Oh. See how they're popping out like that? Okay. So here it is. Can you see? Okay. If I have a six-month-old,
I'm gonna move the pleater right back here.
Yeah, you can just put that on the floor. Okay, this has had water damage, so I'm sorry that you see that right there. But this has been one of my dearest friends for years and years and years.
I actually have one in my trunk.
Do you have one? Mm-hmm. Oh, these are marvelous, and I didn't bring my needles. Because then you have, this is how you block it. What I'm gonna do next, the next step in your garment is called blocking, and that's where you're getting your size. Let's see, this right here, you can see. This is sizes 6 to 12. So this would be like a 6-year-old through a 12-year-old. However, I have found, and this is Cherry Williams, and her, you see how short their dresses are?
Mm-hmm.
I like longer dresses. I always liked them longer rather than at the knee. I just think they're a little bit more elegant that way, but that's just my opinion. And so I always would just lengthen them, and that's not a big deal. But what I have done is I already have the little template. And this is a size 7 blocking guide. Here we go. See? Blocking guide size 7. Now, place on fold. So,
that's halfway.
This is halfway. That's right. And let me get this down here. Okay. So, this goes a little over, not quite, almost 8.5 inches right here, because this is already marked off for you. So, 8.5 and 8.5. You're looking at 17. You don't have to be quite exact, really. There is some room, some wiggle room, I like to say. When you smock, it's not necessarily as exacting as maybe other things. So if I had my needles with me, which I forgot to bring my little pins, use my little pins. So Laura, would you just hold this right here at 17?
Mm-hmm.
So this would be, again, for a size 7, and you're just gonna wiggle it down a little bit, like there.
Can you turn it sideways, maybe?
Yeah. There we go.
So okay. I've seen that you have to make sure when you have this knot on the end that you put them far enough away, if you're doing a larger kid's garment.
Yeah, right. We can go like that so you can have some more
room. I'm just thinking, I would think, I'm going to be really good and just knot
make
it right here
tight.
And then, yeah.
There's so many little steps that I'm not a very good teacher.
It's been a while since you've done it.
It's probably been 4 or 5 years since I have pleated anything up. I have some ongoing projects that I haven't finished. Okay, so I have it kind of evenly spaced, and really right now it's not necessary to have it evenly spaced. So what I would do is I would pin right here and I would pin right there, and then I would take my handy dandy scissors, and I would go ahead and snip off right here. And if I had my needle, I would pluck out. This is just something I have learned over the years. I don't have a needle to pluck out. I'm not sure you would read this necessarily in anybody else's directions. So along this pleat right here, I would stay.
That'd be helpful to pull.
You are wonderful. I would stay right here along this pleat right here, and I'm plucking out so it's the same for each one. And I'll show you what I'm going to do here in just a second. Okay, so I've got those pulled out. I take them 2 by 2, and I tie them as close to the garment as I can get. My hands are kind of shaky. I'm nervous.
The whole world is watching you.
The whole world is watching.
You have to just take comfort in the fact that I'm the one who did this little scallop there.
Oh. Well, hold on. Okay, hold on just a second. Okay, so if I was home, I'd be licking my fingers because my fingers are really dry, and then wet fingers would be able to grip a little better. Okay, here we go. All right, so here's how you get, you want to get as close to the garment as you can. Right there, okay. I didn't get as close as I wanted to, but I haven't done that side yet either. And again, you have your pins right here, so this isn't going to go anywhere. And then...
except you're buckling there. Should I pull it a little tighter?
Definitely. It's exactly what I would do. I'd pull it tight. I wouldn't pull it so tight that I would buckle this right here.
Uh-huh.
Okay. And so see how I've left myself maybe an inch? You can even leave yourself, that might be more than an inch. No, that's probably about an inch. You can leave yourself an inch and a half
Should I do the same thing on this side?
And I would do the exact same thing on that side. Definitely cut, give yourself some room, cut, just cut right there, right by the
just
by
the
knot.
Just with the two though, or all of them?
All of them. Go ahead and just cut.
That seems daring.
Yeah, yeah. You know what? Don't cut yet. Oh, you already did. Yeah, good. Just cut the two. Yeah, and then pull those out. Give yourself an inch. Maybe, yeah.
And tie it tight again.
Mm-hmm. You might get 2 shows out of this one, huh?
Well, and then there's the encore.
Right. You got to see what I do with this garment. I'll give it to Laura. I bequeath it to you. See what you do with it.
I will be known as Mona Lisa from now on.
There you go.
With the mysterious smile that I give you.
Yeah. Okay. Oh my goodness, I am not doing a good job here. Okay, so I've got these three done. Okay, so see these top 2 rows are blocked. And that's what you go on and finish and do. You want to stay along the same pleat on both sides. And then this is what is going to then get sewn into the garment, like under the arm, mm-hmm. you know, because this is going to go right across the chest.
That makes sense because you mm-hmm. don't want to have any heavy pleating, a thickness that you're going to put into a seam.
Exactly.
So you try to do the mm-hmm. embroidery only on the front.
Only on the front. And then right now, we can just leave that right here. I told you I had a garment going, and then this is a skirt. I pleated a skirt. And you just use a regular embroidery needle.
And I can see here that you do have that extra one. That
I do. I actually have 2 extras.
To keep the pleating out of the way.
Uh-huh. And I'll probably, on a skirt, you can even go down to the last row and catch it yourself with whatever, a cable stitch or whatever is mm-hmm. fine, because this is not an inset, so I don't need this to be perfect down here. It's going to splay out then and go on down.
This is such a nice example, though, that, you know, this is what you would travel with when you go to games
I would,
and stuff.
Yes.
It just looks like a piece of fabric.
It does.
And only mm-hmm. in one section do you have that special.
Yeah, and I'll embroidery. Show you here. You see how it's blocked on both sides? I can kind of pull it just uh-huh. a little bit. Again, you've got that wiggle room because of the pleat, so it's going to pull it in a little bit. But when I go to sew it in the garment, it'll keep it, you know, like that. It'll get a little, not tight across the child's chest, but it'll be nice and snug, and that's mm-hmm. kind of what you want. I think this is a size 4. I think, actually, I must have started this a couple years ago for Chloe. So maybe this isn't as old as I thought it was, because I'm pretty sure this is a 4. So anyways, you can see where I've made my ties all the way down mm-hmm. on either side.
That's nice. Yeah, I can still...
And I was going to show you...
I'm sure it's hard to see on the camera, but
probably.
There is a little black
knots.
To me, they look like stitches in someone's skin.
Yeah. Oh, I know, right?
Yeah.
Okay, and so then you use floss. You can pick any colors you want. This is a geometric that I had just did myself. I wasn't following anybody's idea, any plan. So you don't have to have all that extra stuff. If you were going, you can just do geometrics.
So wait a minute. If you didn't follow any plans, did you count out and figure out how it was going to be exact up and down?
Not at all.
How come it works then?
It works just because this is going to get sewn basically under the armpits, and you're not going to see it finish anyway.
But you have a perfect X coming out, like you don't have
I?
A fabric.
I'm that this good.
You are that good.
No, I think that just worked out.
That's wonderful.
Yeah, I didn't start in the middle. I just started on one side and went that way. A lot of times if you have a...
Oh, sure. If you have a pictorial, you have to start.
You're going to start in the middle, and you're going to go to the right, and then you're going to go to the left. Well, no, you never go to the left. You always smock like you read from left to right.
Really?
Why? Yes.
Oh, because your thread is
because
running
because I'm right-handed, and that's the way I go. I don't.
But still, if you were looping it this way,
yes.
Then you're not going to start looping it backwards.
Yes.
So you do have to have the stitch running in the
same. And I think where did I stop? Okay, so I stopped here. Can you see that? I stopped right here. This little yellow. This is a two baby waves down, and then this is a cable, and I'm going to do two baby waves up, and I'm going to be right underneath that. Purple cable, and I'm going to go back down and back up. So when you floss in the directions, if you do purchase directions to have something to follow when you first learn, they will tell you that you use four of the, when you buy floss, it comes in six threads, and you'll use four of the six threads. So
all you're using is a standard cross-stitch thread.
Exactly.
It's not anything special where you have to go to a smocker store and buy smocking thread.
So if you've ever cross-stitched before, this part then would be really easy for you, and you know how to just tap it to get it to separate. And then if you pull it straight out it comes separate from the second one. And, of course, I've already used the other four on this one.
Where were you when I started to cross-stitch? All you have to do is tap
it? Just tap it, and they splay, and then you can pick one out. Of course, I already have it cut. So what I'm going to do here is I'm just going to double it, so I'll have my four. And then I'm going to cut it like that. And then, okay, so forgive me. I am going to lick that. And I'm going to thread my needle. And I did bring my glasses, but I think the lights here are bright enough that I can, yep, I got that right in there. Okay, so here you go. I've got my needle threaded. I am going to knot the end right there, just like that. Okay, so then you pick up your garment.
I can tell this isn't your first rodeo.
This is not my first rodeo. You want to come up in the valley between the pleats, so you're going to have to pick it apart when you first come up.
Do you use a regular sharp needle?
Yep, this is just a regular embroidery needle. I'm sure there's...
Okay, because it has to have a larger...
You need a larger head.
Eye, yeah.
To get the threads through.
And you did knot it.
And I
so
did.
So the knot just slips into the valley, like you said, so it's not going to be anything anyone feels.
Mm-mm. Well, I guess your child, if some kids are really sensitive and they can feel stuff like that, if your child is that sensitive, you can get like a piece of batiste and just hand sew it, you know, so then it's
over
comfortable.
The edge. That's interesting,
against their skin, or they can just wear a little slip or something like that. It's fine. So, okay, I'm just going to do a couple stitches, and then that'll be probably, unless you have any other questions, we can keep doing whatever, but I wanted to show you. So I'm going to wave up. I already have my cable right there, so I'll catch the next pleat right there, and then I'm going to go right up under a down cable right there. So I waved up twice. So you see that?
Yep.
And then I'm going to make a cable. So I just go right to the next pleat.
Mm-hmm.
This is an up cable.
I understand.
But my thread's coming down.
Right.
Okay. Even though that's an up cable, my thread's coming down. So I'll get my thread over, and I'm going to catch the next pleat about in the middle because I want the two waves. Sometimes if your floss gets buckled or you have one piece, you can pull it back out like that, just like when you cross stitch, and then just tighten it. You don't want it really tight. You want everything to be just snug, nothing really, really tight. And then I don't have it close enough to me right now. So there I baby waved down. I'm going to do a down cable. And when you do a down cable, you're just right next to where your thread came out, so you're right parallel to it. You're not at any kind of an angle.
So then these are straight stitches. Another way to think of cable is to think of a straight stitch. It's right next to it. And then I just keep doing that until I get to the end. And then you can just do whatever you want to do.
Right. Well, I think that you have really simplified what would have been just completely flummoxing to see, like I said, an heirloom piece with lots of beautiful pleating and lots of beautiful embroidery, and you're just pulling it out and just going for it. But I can see how it is like cross-stitch, uh-huh. because you're going up and going down. The thing that's different is instead of just making an X, there are just a few different stitches that you need to learn
there
to master.
Mm-hmm.
But it doesn't
and
sound
with cross-stitch,
like,
you know, you're going through the garment to the back side and then
and
back
with this,
through.
You're
and,
catching the top only.
And yes, you just catch the top of the pleats. And so there's so many different stitches and different needlework that you can do to, you know, decorate it any way you want.
Okay.
I could have just left it like this and did back smocking.
Right.
And then that's just pretty even by itself. You don't even have to do the front
embroidery at all.
Mm-mm. You don't
have
to.
Might be a good idea for a first project.
Definitely. And then you could practice your cable.
So let's say that there is someone out there that has their first grandkid, or they know of a christening, and they're thinking, well, maybe I could do it. What advice would you give to somebody interested in smocking?
Well, now we have this wonderful resource called the internet and YouTube.
Absolutely.
You could just type in YouTube, how to smock, basic smocking stitches, and I'm sure people have uploaded any number, or you can call somebody that you know knows about it, like me, and say, hey, I'd like to learn. And then I would say, go get your garment and come on over, and I'll pleat it up for you, and we'll have a go at it. And that's fun. I would enjoy that. So that would be fine if you're, you know, bent on doing something new.
That's a wonderful resource.
Mm-hmm.
And another wonderful resource is the library. I know our library has at least one book on smocking, and then there's interlibrary loan.
Yes.
And I did look up what could be available, and there's mm-hmm. quite a few books. And sometimes it's nice just to leaf through and get pictures.
Absolutely.
And get ideas before mm-hmm. you know, even ideas of what color garment.
Yeah.
Because there can be so many choices out there. The choices with the internet are absolutely unlimited.
Unlimited. If you do want a name of somebody trusted who has done this for years, I would say Martha Pullen would be one. And I was actually watching her the other day just to kind of, I haven't done it in a while, so I just wanted to get it in my head, you know, things to say or whatever. And she has got so many step-by-step, and I think it was just MarthaPullen.com, and she's kind of like the Elvis of of the smocking world. So she's definitely the go-to girl.
Is she Australian? I know there's...
No.
She
talks like this. She's from, I think, Alabama.
All right.
Could be Georgia. It might be Georgia, but yeah.
So it's a deep south thing. I know that
it is a deep south thing.
There's a big smocking thing in
Australia
as well.
I think the pleater I have, the Amanda Jane, is an Australian pleater. And then, of course, Martha Pullen has her own pleater too. If I have that right, I'm pretty sure.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much for sharing. You are a multi-talented woman. Tune into her Cooking with Cana show.
Yes.
On RTC, and I'm just so thankful that you came and that you're a friend and that you're so talented on multi-levels.
Well, I really appreciate it.
Your family is blessed to have you.
Aw, thank you so much.
Welcome to the Book Corner of In the Loop with Laura. We have today something I got out of the Fulton County Library. It's called 155 Smocking Designs. They don't go into great detail about how to make the garment, but they have many, many designs, and it's local. It's something that you can check out. It is by Teresa Santoso, S-A-N-T-O-S-O. And if you look at some of the things that are inside, when Cana was talking to us about smocking, she talked about geometric designs like this, and here it's pointed out. Each line is a different pleat, and you can go up and down and create geometric designs. Again, very similar to cross stitch, only we have lines instead of a grid pattern. So they have lots of geometric designs, very easy geometric designs. We have flowers using different stitches. We have Christmas ideas. We have animals. And so here's just a single one, and you can decide I want this one and that one, or you can do a whole bunch of dinosaurs going across the front of a boy's smocked top. Here are fruits. And then when you come to the very beginning, we have stitch symbols and ways to understand. So not only the herringbone or chevron stitches that might be the normal ones, but here, honeycomb stitches, lazy daisy, French knots, and I'm sure that they decide or they tell you in other places how to make each of those. So this is a very good resource for anyone who just wants to find out more. You don't have to do it if you check this out. 155 Smocking Designs by Teresa Samazo. It's in our local library. Please check it out. Thanks for joining me.